what's the deal with Iran? Well, I have recently produced a few videos on the Iran deal, with each one becoming outdated faster than the latest iPhone. I swear, it's never a good sign when the most consistent part of your deal is the Middle East. So, I went over what is going on briefly in the last video, but the more important story in this case is what people say is going on. Because, depending on which source you watch, you're either getting two entirely different stories, with some people jumping for joy, while others are jumping for cover. Today, I'm going to be looking at Fox News and MSNBC, and basically reporting on the reporting. Wow, meta. So first, because I want to feel happy, let's see what Fox News is saying. Here's National Security Advisor John Bolton talking to Presidential Advisor Fox and Friends about the deal.
This deal was badly negotiated. It was conceived with a wrong view of its consequences for the United States and Iran. I mean, really, it rested on the notion that if we could just resolve the nuclear problem, Iran's behavior would change for the better. Exactly the opposite has taken place. Iran's behavior has gotten worse.
This is a very interesting point, because Iran's behavior might have gotten worse because of this deal. According to CNBC, I use you guys as the liberal side. You can't be agreeing. Every day, it seems like Iran is provoking the US with another incident. Just Monday, Iranian gunboats harassed yet another US naval vessel. And Saturday, the Iranians conducted a provocative and possibly illegal test of Russian-made S-300 surface-to-air laser-guided missile defense systems. Yes! That government is definitely not next in line for the Nobel Peace Prize, and this deal probably didn't help that. The article went on to express, as bad as Iran had acted on the world stage since 1979, its nefarious reach was significantly muted for decades by the sanctions and their economic effect. Turns out that giving a country that might do worse on a cognitive test than Donald Trump billions in frozen assets and legitimacy on the world stage for trade, in exchange for them not building nukes and giving up certain materials, might not be a perfect idea. But there is one thing I want you to keep in mind as we keep talking. As I've said earlier, I'm pretty meh on the Iran deal, and I can see why people would be angry in July of 2015 when it was ratified. I mean, believe me, if anyone telling you it's a perfect deal, chances are they either work for an Iranian bank or an American who really doesn't want to see the nuclear war. That said, there is a difference between the quality of the deal and leaving the deal entirely. Because, first, we paid up front. Because according to Foreign Policy magazine, based on the calculation, its overseas assets, which will likely be unfrozen, will total north of $20 billion. Really, Obama? We're paying cash up front to a country that, well, back in 2015, I would have said would have broken this treaty immediately. The other big benefit we gave is getting our friends together in a group and saying, hey, it's cool to trade with Iran again, which they promptly did. And those two things really brought Iran to the negotiating table. My point is that, to some people, this discussion would be like if my friend walked up to me and told me he had just bought a new Mazda for $200,000. I would say, well, that was really dumb. But I probably wouldn't say, well, let's set that thing on fire and abandon it in a parking lot in Paramus, New Jersey. Wow, John Bolton must have really inspired me right there, so let's get back to that interview.
A number of Democrats have said the message to North Korea is you can't trust the United States. We had a deal with Iran and they can't trust us and neither should the North Koreans. What's your message to the Democrats who are saying that?
Well, they're completely wrong. We had a rotten deal with Iran, and just as George W. Bush withdrew from the 1972 ABM treaty because it was not in America's strategic interest, that's what the president has done here. I think it sends a very important message to North Korea that we're not in these negotiations with them just to get a deal. We're going to get the right deal.
This ABM treaty was the first time the U.S. withdrew from a major arms treaty.
Today, I have given formal notice to Russia, in accordance with the treaty, that the United States of America is withdrawing from this almost 30-year-old treaty. I have concluded the ABM treaty hinders our government's ability to develop ways to protect our people from future terrorists or rogue state missile attacks.
Yeah, that treaty was weird. It basically limited the number of missiles you can use to shoot down incoming nuclear weapons. And I could explain the logic behind that, but oh man, that's its own episode and a half. Alright, so we pulled out and it didn't ruin our reputation. I mean, heck, we managed to get Iran to make a deal with us. The way he's talking about it, it seems that he's almost leveraging the harm to our reputation in the upcoming North Korean negotiations. Because we're gonna get the right deal, and if we don't like it, apparently, we're gonna make like the iTunes service agreement and click yes before doing whatever we want to. The main thing is, with a reputation for breaking deals, they're probably gonna want cash up front. Something that might not be great. Especially with a regime that makes Iran look about as reliable as the sun coming up tomorrow. Although, this does show us that the regime gives us a deal we don't like, we might shake your hands, but we won't mean it. And if you take advantage of the fine print, well, then we'll just take away all of the print. One thing I have to point out, though, is that we withdrew from the ABM treaty legally, using an exit written into the agreement. Whereas, in this case, we're violating the core portion of it by putting sanctions against Iran. Meaning that we're still in the agreement in the same way that North Korea holds elections. Hey, what do you know? The man who's believed to be God won again. Man, I really thought political prisoner 156 had a chance this year. Next, he talked about,
will the sanctions work even if we don't get participation from our European allies?
Well, the sanctions take effect immediately, so there's no new business allowed under the terms that are prescribed. For existing contracts, there are wind-down provisions that come into effect, and the Treasury Department and others will be laying those out in more detail.
Well, all right, so the sanctions are coming back into place. Well, the U.S. sanctions, because the other signatories with actual investment aren't too keen to dissolve that. These are Iran's trading partners, and this is our portion. Can we zoom that in a little bit? Yeah, okay, that white highlighted section is the amount Iran exports to the US. So you can imagine how badly our sanctions are gonna hurt. Just to bring it back to normal. You see that little white spot? You might need a big screen 4K TV to see it, but if they lose that little sliver, people are assuming that it's gonna be game over. Maybe someone's been reading David and Goliath too many times. He went on to argue that
our sanctions have enormous effect on Europe already. Licenses of American technology, if American companies can't use those licenses to sell to Iran, neither is anybody else. So we're going to be talking to the Europeans.
Which is an interesting argument, although a bit odd, because it's not focusing on Iranian exports, but rather Iranian imports, because, well, they do import a fair amount more from us. Hey, it's big enough that our name actually made it this time. Yes, we make up this portion. The argument here is that we can leverage our intellectual property to make it so that no country will sell made in America goods in Iran. That said, if you look at what we export to Iran, well, I wouldn't invest in soybean companies anytime soon. To be fair, European exports are actually diverse. Although, it might be hard to convince them to cut their exports considering they're trying to maintain manufacturing jobs and exports. Oh, and they actually want to keep the Iran deal in place, so that might be a hard sell. We do have ways of changing their mind though, because courts reported any European company with a US arm that agreed to deal with Iran would now be violating US law. Those not active in the US could be hit with a with us or against us sanction, in which Washington would tell the company that if it wants to keep trading with Iran, they can't trade with America. Man, just when you thought Europe couldn't hate Donald Trump anymore. How bad could this really be though? Energy giants like Total Paywall and Royal Dutch Shell have lucrative agreements to work with Iran. Renault has a joint venture to make 150,000 cars a year, and Franco-German plane manufacturer Airbus has reportedly delivered just 3 out of 100 jets promised to Iran, in a deal worth billions. Well, that sounds pretty official. Weirdly enough, I found a very interesting argument for why we should leave the Iran deal from liberal-leaning Vox News. If Iran were to race to the bomb, they would lose the support they still have right now in Europe and elsewhere. In other words, President Trump has some time here to ratchet up the pressure against Iran and use any other means of state power possible to coerce the regime to change its behavior. Basically, us leaving the deal isn't going to make Iran change their behavior and start trying to manufacture a nuclear weapon. Because last time they did that, we were able to convince countries that actually matter to them, China, to stop buying their products. This gives us the opportunity to figure out new ways to put pressure on them. Although, I'm not sure what we have now that we unfroze their assets. We'll figure something out. We have time. Now, I'd like to end this section with what I believe to be the most compelling argument in support of leaving. What we just did was give ourselves more options that are non-military. Remember, the deal took all of our non-military, economically coercive options off the table. Before this, our only option in dealing with Iran was a military strike. But now we can go back to using more peaceful methods of dealing with aggravations, like the aforementioned Iranian gunships harassing US Navy vessels. Alright. So now to MSNBC, because I have some terrified liberals to calm down. First off, Iran really took this update in stride.
The highest authority in the land, the supreme leader, spoke this morning and he said when Trump is long gone and dead and snakes and ants are feeding on his corpse, the Islamic Republic will still be standing strong.
Hey, at least it's not death to America, right? Alright, so let's get into it.
Say you're North Korea, and you're about to have a summit with the President of the United States for the first time in history. You're about to have the summit because you're supposedly about to start talking about a deal, a negotiated deal to stop your nuclear program in exchange for something from the United States. What does it say to you that the United States just today unilaterally broke the last deal that it did with another country to try to stop a nuclear program?
So the optics really aren't great on this one, and frankly, I can't deepen the argument very much. Except to say that, for what it's worth, third parties are reporting that this doesn't seem to bother Kim Jong-un. But those are the same people who wanted Trump to leave the Iran deal, so who knows? I'd say we don't break treaties often, but if that were true, Native Americans would still own half this country. Her guest, a nuclear security analyst, said,
I read the transcript for the State Department background briefing today. The reporters were all over these briefers. It was a mess. It's clear they have no idea how to put back sanctions that they claim will now force Iran to come crawling back for a better deal.
Yeah, you know what? I think best case scenario right now, surprisingly, is that Iran starts trying to make nuclear weapons so we can get China back on board. Until then, we only have one option, and unfortunately, it's not financial, as us threatening Iran economically would be like me boycotting Lamborghinis. Yeah, okay, maybe I'll save up my entire adult life so I can buy one of your custom racing gloves. The option we have is,
what is the real plan here? And the fear is that it's John Bolton's plan. It's a plan to actually go to war with Iran. I wouldn't say that Bolton is manipulating the president, but John Bolton operationalizes Trump's worst impulses. And that could get us into the biggest conflict yet.
Wow, that escalated quickly. Yes, while people who defend the Iran deal are saying that we are now free to pursue non-military options in handling Iran, some skeptics are saying we're going to war with Iran, something we could have done while the existing agreement was there.
I have concerns that the US government couldn't, just as a capability, couldn't institute some complex new sanctions plan against our allies, even if we wanted to.
I think that's right, and the State Department officials had a great deal of difficulty explaining how this would work. Remember, the United States doesn't do business with Iran, so you can't sanction our companies. So that means you have to sanction European companies, Japanese companies, Chinese companies.
Well, that's the thing, because from what I've read, these sanctions don't feel at all complicated, more just dicky. It's not exactly hard to figure out how to put in a with us or against us clause. It's just hard to come up with a comprehensive strategy to live with yourself after doing that. One point here, though, that some are making is that if we were to sanction European companies, Iran would just turn more towards China, a country that has already said nope to Trump calls and threats for re-sanctions. So there you have it, the Iran deal, love it or leave it. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this last video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan comedy news, remember to subscribe by clicking on my eagle, or do it the old-fashioned way by clicking the subscribe button below. And remember to give me a thumbs up. And lastly, as always, thank you for watching.